Let's get started. Couple of announcements. First of all, some people have asked what the course homepage is. That is the course homepage. That has a link to the Moodle site where we will be posting discussions, homeworks, labs, and such dynamic data. Static content like slides, other resources, notes will be all there. Second announcement is that on Moodle you will find a new posting giving you links to required reading. So there are some pages in Wikipedia about binary numbers, how to manipulate them, as well as new pointers to Professor Ranade's upcoming textbook. To keep some sync with the lectures, every week now we will announce some chapters or sections to read from Professor Ranade's book, and you should complete reading that before you go to the tutorial. Okay? If you have problems understanding some parts of the book or my previous lectures, hopefully one of them may help solve the other, and if in spite of reading the chapters you cannot resolve your problems, then take those questions to the TAs in the tutorial section. There are also some feedback that not everyone is clear with how the system works and how your code is executed. So I thought I'll spend 5 to 10 minutes cleaning up that part, and then we'll proceed and continue with loops. So this was the first complete source code we saw. We do this thing called include IOStream, and we'll see what it does in a couple of slides in pictures. Then you access things inside the IOStream library by using a certain namespace. That we have already covered. We basically said that things like cin and cout, you can compare them to people living in hostels. In particular, the hostel in this case with the namespace std or the standard library. And either you have to refer to them by the full name giving the hostel number, or you have to say using hostel 5, and then whoever you refer to is by default in hostel 5. And then you write this main routine, and now you are allowed to use cin and cout, which are references to facilities inside the IOStream library. Now you can save this to a file which you can arbitrarily call cf.cc, centigrade to Fahrenheit, whatever name you choose. Typically the compiler will ask that you end the file name with either .cc or .cpp, C++ by convention. This is a text file. You submit that to the G++ compiler. G++ cf.cc outputs a file called a.out. This is another file. You cannot read that file. It's an executable file. So cf.cc and a.out are files. A file is just a sequence of bytes. Until you try to use it, it doesn't matter what that sequence of bytes is. This sequence of bytes is interpreted and used differently depending on who is reading or writing that file. cf.cc is a text file to be written by a programmer and then to be read by the C++ compiler. a.out is an executable file to be run from the shell command line, and you can rename this file as you wish. This organization you have seen, so this is the new picture. Let me explain this carefully part by part. The hardware assets of the computer are shown in the lowermost layer, the CPU, RAM, disk, keyboard and display, maybe a mouse as well. These hardware resources are managed by the operating system, which may be Windows, Linux, macOS, etc. On top of the operating system, there will be two things running. One is the bash shell by which you interact with the hardware and make programs run. And the other is the C or C++ or C and C++ execution environment, which actually comes into being when bash invokes your main function in a.out. The main function you wrote in the source code is packaged up as a function and placed in a.out in suitable binary format. And when you type .a.out in bash, what it does is to transfer control to the main function inside a.out. Now this compiled code runs with the help of the C and C++ execution environment. The execution environment supports certain things in your code in what's called native mode. So it understands what a character is, it understands what a short is, it understands what an int, float, double is, and it can represent those in RAM. And if you have written statements using if, switch or while, as we have seen, those are executed directly using the C++ execution environment. But you may be using more complex things like finding the square root of a number or using the keyboard or display to read or write values to the screen, or you may be doing string manipulations. Those are not directly supported inside the runtime environment. The runtime environment does low level activity, controlling statement, operations, transferring control in a while loop and so on. Whereas more complicated functions are implemented inside these libraries. The libraries come in two parts. One is pre-compiled code, which is embedded in the C++ execution environment. Just like you compiled your code into an executable, other people wrote these complicated libraries and they were compiled into library files. But to be able to use them, the pre-compiled libraries also provide some header files. The header files basically just list what all facilities are offered in each of the libraries. When your code includes these header files, it basically gets to know the names of all the variables and methods or functions that are defined in the respective libraries. That is the hash include statement. Okay? So if you didn't do that hash include, the G++ compiler would see cin or cout or square root or so on log, and it couldn't figure out what you mean because it didn't say which library you have to draw it from. Once you do the include, the G++ compiler will know. So it does what is called a linking process. So it links in whatever you need from those libraries into your code. And your code itself does not include that code as such. It just has a reference to that code. Those libraries are running, are available inside the execution environment, and they are executed from your code whenever needed. Okay? That is the entire model of execution. So the reason why the libraries are split up into two parts is because the header, the list of facilities provided, is usually much shorter than the whole implementation. The implementation is much longer. And the system is organized so that multiple people running C++ programs can share one copy of the code in those libraries kept in the system. That's the reason why these things are separated out. Okay. Any questions on this? So you should be clear on at least your view of how to compile a code, how is it running, why is main important, and how upon invoking various things from inside main, you are utilizing facilities provided by C++ libraries. After that, we will resume with the matter of while loops. So the last example we saw was how to raise a floating point number, say double base, to a non-negative integer power, pow. Okay? And the first solution we saw was quite simple. You initialize a variable called todo to the power you have to raise, and then you keep on decrementing todo and you multiply answer by base each time. So this results in a number of multiplications which is exactly equal to the power. Okay? And then we saw that there is a more efficient version which uses the so-called squaring method. And the insight for this came from the binary representation of the power. Okay? See, the power variable can be expressed as a sum of powers of 2. And in the specific case where pow is already a power of 2, like 32, we saw that there is no need to multiply base together 31 times, spending 31 multiplications. Instead, we can do repeated squaring. We can first take base and square it to get base squared. Then without using base at all, we can get base to the power 4 and so on. And within 5 multiplications, we can get to base to the power 32. So instead of approximately 32 or 32 minus 1 multiplications, we can use just log 32 to the base 2, namely 5 multiplications. And so this is far more efficient. Now, once we can deal with a pow value, which is a power of 2, we can also deal with pow values, which are not powers of 2. Suppose I get the value 29, I can always express it as a sum of powers of 2. That is its binary representation. And then I will compute the powers of base, which are powers of 2, as I go through a loop, and I'll accumulate or multiply in suitable parts of those. So as I was saying, let the bit position bx take values from 0 through 7. Let's say pow is a byte, which is 29. 29 in binary looks like 1 plus 4 plus 8 plus 16. So what I'll do is I'll keep squaring base as before, and as bx sweeps from right to left, if the bxth bit of the power is 1, then I'll include the power of base in the product, otherwise I won't. So for example, if power is equal to 29, it's clear that base to the power 29 is the same as base to the power 1 times base to the power 4 times base to the power 8 times base to the power 16. Okay? Now, we already know how to get a particular bit in a number by using the logical AND. And we'll basically be using that trick. So this is the faster code. I initialize to do to pow again. This time I have an answer which is 1 just like before, but I also have a term which will start with base to the power 1, but then it will be squared. Okay, every step I'll square term. So it will be base, base squared, base to the power 4, base to the power 8 and so on. So while to do is greater than 1, if the least significant bit of to do is 1, then I'll product term into answer. Otherwise I won't. But in any case, I will square term and I will shift to do by 1. So instead of saying I am looking at bits one by one, I am scanning left, an equivalent action is to shift this number right and look at the rightmost bit. Okay. So instead of having a bit pointer and then, you know, moving that left and reading what bit there is, I can get the equivalent effect by taking this original number, looking at the least significant bit and keep shifting it right until zeros are injected from the left and the number totally becomes 0. Okay. And that is why I declared it as unsigned, so that the bits injected from the left will always be zeros. Otherwise, you know, we might get in some trouble. So this will also calculate the power of base. And in this case, the loop invariant may not be exactly the same, but it may also be the same. So as a homework, you can just check out what the loop invariant is going to be. Okay. Remember last time in the slow code, the loop invariant was answer times base to the power to do was base to the power pow after every loop iteration. So this time see what it's going to be. Okay. Now what if power is a real number instead of an integer? How are you going to deal with that? So think about that offline. We can always take the integer part of it separately and do it this way, and then you get a fraction, and then you have to do something else with that part. Okay. So we ran this code and we saw that although, you know, we didn't measure the time taken by it, the faster code should be faster because it has far fewer multiplications. But at the end of it, we saw that the values were slightly different, right? So when printed, the slow method and the fast method output what looked like the exact same double number. But if you compare them as saying if fast value is equal to slow value, the answer was no, they are not equal. And we saw that the reason was limitations in machine accuracy. Because of the finite number of bits used to represent numbers, raise them to powers and multiply them, it turned out that the slow and the fast value differed in the last 2 bits of the mantissa. Okay. And I use some tricks to print it out that way, you don't need to understand the tricks. The point is a double precision number is 8 bytes long, so that's, you know, however many bits. I found a method to print out all the bits of the double precision number. And then we found that the mantissa differed in very small significance bits, but because a test for equality is an exact test for bitwise equality, that did not work out. So that's another lesson for if you are doing numerical algorithms and you expect equality between floating point numbers, you may sometimes need to do the test with a epsilon tolerance threshold. So you have to say, you know, the absolute value of one thing minus the other should be less than some small amount instead of looking for exact bitwise equality. So the next example we'll look for is the factorial example. Okay. So suppose I want to calculate the factorial of number n. I initialize say long int fact to 1 and I read in n, and then initially don't read the 0.5. So say while n is greater than 0. Okay. And this is one of the slightly annoying but nifty ways to code in C++. You say factorial is multiplied by n, but after that I decrement it within the loop. Okay. And then you test again whether n has become 0 or not. So until the time n goes down to 1, you keep multiplying by n. Okay. So this avoids the need to declare some other intermediate variable like I and clocking it up from I equal to 1 to n. You can also do it that way. There will be no difference. Okay. Now, this can easily overflow even for moderate n, right? Even if you use double. So I crossed out the long int and put double in the hope that I can find factorials of largish numbers. But let's see how far that will take us. So remember, the largest double is approximately 10 to the power 308. So n factorial is roughly equal to 10 to the power 3.8 if n log n is roughly log of 10 to the power 308. So n factorial is log of n factorial is roughly n log n, okay, roughly speaking. So n log n is roughly 709, or n is roughly 709 divided by log of 709, which is just 108. So after calculating the factorial of 108, double can't hold it anymore. Okay. So if you want to compute factorials of even larger numbers, then neither long long int nor double will do the trick. And you need to use some libraries for what are called infinite precision integers, which actually use an arbitrary number of bytes in RAM to pack larger and larger integers. Okay. So another example, let's try to approximate the logarithm of a number to the base 10. So one definition of the logarithm crudely is how many times must we divide a number x by 10 until the result goes below 1. That's the integer part of some logarithm, okay, it's plus minus 1. Now the basic structure is the same. You read in the floating point number x, okay, and then you count the number of divisions you have done. So you say int numdivs equal to 0, and then you say while x stays above 1, I divide x by 10 and I increment numdivs. You can also do that by saying plus plus numdivs, and then I print out the number of divisions I made. Okay. So that's a way to approximate the logarithm of a number. So sometimes the part that's shown in the red color at the top is called the prologue or the prelude of the loop, then there's the loop body, and then there's the epilogue of the loop, whatever you do afterwards. In this case, some of them are trivial. We're just doing initialization and printing, but sometimes they are more important than this. Any questions about the examples so far? So instead of writing x equal to x slash 10, as we saw, we can write x slash equal to 10, or you could say numdivs plus equal to 1 or plus plus numdivs. So quick review, what have we done so far? We looked at a bunch of data types, and we also looked fairly closely at how they are represented in RAM. Some part of that might have been unfamiliar, you haven't done binary arithmetic before, so it might take a little effort to figure out a few of those tricks. Why do we care? Okay. We care because we want to understand the limits of what can be represented and what cannot be represented within the hardware limitations. Okay. We will see many more examples of that in the upcoming while loop examples in this lecture. Why do we want to understand the limits? So that we can write more reliable and robust code. Okay, if you already know that you cannot represent the factorial of a number greater than about 108 reliably, and if that number sticks in your mind, then anytime you want to do, say, series summations, right? See, if you try to calculate the factorial of a larger number, then it will go to infinity, right? And so later on, suppose you're calculating e to the power x as a series and there's this factorial somewhere. So you kind of understand that beyond that point, the denominator becomes infinite and I should be careful about manipulating that expression, right? So having this few constants in your mind is good if you're writing programs which easily go near the limits or beyond the limits. And they also give us insights for better algorithms. For example, we started with understanding the bit representation of integers, and somehow it's stuck that every bit is worth twice the bit before, and in a way that led to the squaring trick. So instead of counting through the power one by one and multiplying base each time, we figured out this trick that because every bit position is worth twice the previous one, that's equivalent to squaring base as we shift. Okay. So sometimes representation can also give you ideas for better algorithms. So that's the reason we care. Next example. So this is the way Archimedes originally found the area of the value of pi. Okay. So what he did was he took a circle of radius half. Okay. A circle has radius half, then its circumference is 2 pi r or exactly pi. So then he started inscribing polygons with larger and larger number of sides inside the circle. Okay. So suppose we start with a hexagon with 6 sides. Now every segment of that hexagon is an equilateral triangle. So if the radius is half, then the side is also of length half. So there are 6 sides of length half. So I start with a lower approximation to pi, which is 3. Okay. Now we have first a polygon with say sides x in general. So this edge is x long, and so now, if we double the number of sides by bisecting that wedge and making this the new wedge, which is half as wide in degrees, then this segment is x over 2 long, right? Now, let's mark up these values. So this is half unit long, that is x over 2 long, then how long is A? By Pythagoras theorem, A is square root of half squared minus x over 2 squared. Right? What is B then? Remember, the radius is half, therefore B is half minus A. Okay? And then what is y? Y is the hypotenuse of another right angle triangle. So y is equal to x over 2 squared plus b squared, square root. Okay. So now we started with the side length of one polygon. We have doubled that polygon. Now we can solve for the side length of the next polygon. Okay. Now originally we had six sides with length half each. Next, what will happen is the length will go from half to something complicated given by y, but the number of sides will go from 6 to 12, right? Then 12 will become 24. And the new y in terms of the previous x will have this relationship. Okay. So let's code this up. Can we use this to get the entire circumference? So we'll get the total circumference of a polygon that's getting closer and closer to the circle. And so eventually we expect the circumference to be pi. So, here is the kind of code that we can write. So, you start off with double sides equal to 6 and x equal to 0.5. Those are the initial conditions. And then suppose you go in an infinite loop, we print out the perimeter which is sides times x. Okay? And then we calculate those three values. We calculate a, b and y. These are simple expressions. You can draw on the math.h library. And then you can write square root expressions. So square root 1 minus x into x divided by 2 and so on. Okay? And then calculate a, b and y. And then we make a transition. We make y the new x and we double the number of sides. Okay? The last two lines in the loop, they make a transition from one iteration to the next. They make y the new x and they multiply the number of sides by 2. Okay? Anyone not clear with this code? You need a couple of more moments to look at the code. What's happening? Clear? So let's code this up. So it's exactly that code, except that instead of using cout, I'm using the printf library to do some pretty printing. You can see it better, but there's nothing fancy in it. So ignore that line. I'm just printing out sides and the perimeter, sides and sides times x. Okay, that's all you need to see. And then I'm doing exactly what I was saying in the slide. So let's compile this. Okay. And let's print this out. I'll actually pipe it through what's called a less command, where I can stop the output so it doesn't scroll past infinitely fast, so you can see what's happening slowly. So 6 sides, perimeter is 3, 12 sides, perimeter is 3.1, 3000 odd sides, sides is 3.14159. Okay. So as far as I remember the first several digits, it's what's the correct value? 3.14159 something, I've forgotten beyond that. About 300,000 sides. Okay. So seems getting closer and closer to pi, you can look up, and then the number of sides gets into scientific notation because it's too large to print as an integer. And seems like these things are getting closer and closer to pi. Keep going, keep going. Okay. Seems like it's not changing at all here. So seems like things have stabilized, but still let's keep going. Okay. Sort of looks like mostly like pi. Number of sides has become astronomical now. 10 to the power 98 sided polygon. Okay, because I'm doubling, it's very easy to increase the number of sides drastically, very quickly. Oh, what happened there? So at the time that the number of sides has reached around 10 to the power 160, funny things start happening. And then suddenly at 10 to the power 161, I'm back to perimeter equal to 3. Why did that happen? And then the perimeter has become 0. And okay, go long enough, the grand finale is become a NaN. Okay, So clearly, you know, the reason Archimedes succeeded is because Archimedes did not have a modern computer. He stopped much earlier than this. Okay. So this is again happening because of limited precision in representing floating point numbers. What's happening is that an extremely large number of sides is being multiplied by an extremely small side length. And in the limit, we are kind of getting towards infinite number times zero length. And the system precision can't deal with it. Okay. So although if you are trying to do this analytically, you will understand that there is a limit. The machine cannot deal with limits very well, especially limits of the form 0 over 0 or 0 times infinity. Those don't go down very well. So if you are computing some kind of a value which is the limit of an expression, you need to be very careful. And I don't even know of the whole science there about, given a finite machine precision which can't distinguish between values which are too close, up to what point should you iterate this to get the best approximation to pi, right? If you had a table somewhere, someone gave you the whole value of pi to a glorious 10,000 digits, say, not whole value ever, you could compare with this and say, look, we reached the best accuracy at so many sides, and then accuracy started suffering again as a post-mortem analysis. But if no one gave you the true value of pi, can you figure out where to stop so you get the best value of pi? That's a very fascinating subject. We won't go into that in much depth, but we'll do some of it, okay, later on. So you can see that much caution is required. It's not just using an Archimedes, you know, theorem and just crunching it through. And it's not just that you lose accuracy. Eventually, you'll get NaN. So it's pretty serious. So the reason is that is this effect, sides times x. X goes to 0. The side of the wedge goes to 0. Sides goes to infinity. Any questions on this? Okay, but that's not the only way of finding pi. People have found pi in many, many ways. So another way is to do what's called numerical integration. So we take a full circle, we cut it in half. Let's say the radius of the circle is 1, so the area is pi r squared, right? So its area is pi, and therefore the area of the semicircle is pi over 2, it's half pi. Now what's the equation of this? If we take only the positive part of the semicircle, between x equal to minus 1 and x equal to plus 1, the y at any point is positive square root of 1 minus x squared. Everyone happy with that, right? Okay. So because x squared plus y squared equal to 1 is the equation of the circle. So we will approximate the area under the function fx between x and x plus h. Okay, we'll have an interval of width h which will gradually shrink. And then the area will be approximated, that one bar will be of width h at the bottom and fx high. So the area of that one bar is h times fx. And then we'll sum up the areas under those bars to approximate the area. So the inaccuracy will come from the tiny notches at the upper boundary. So it's a smooth curve. We're going to approximate it by some bunch of steps. So that's where the inaccuracy is going to be. But as h becomes smaller and smaller, the estimate should become more accurate. But by now we have wised up. So we know that if h decreases indefinitely, we'll again perhaps fall in trouble. Right? So how do we implement this? This is again extremely simple. Show the second version. Suppose, you know, before Archimedes 1 sort of flamed out, it showed a level of stability. So there was some period of stability when the value of pi was sort of constant and then it started degenerating. Okay? Suppose you want to detect that and break away at that point. Okay. So the way to implement that is, instead of saying while true, I will have a Boolean variable called keep going. Okay. I'll initialize that to true. So I'll say while keep going. So I'll enter the loop. Okay. And then after I compute x and y, so I'll initially remember the perimeter as sides times x as before. When I compute y and I multiply sides by 2, after doing this assignment, I will compute the new perimeter as sides times x again. Note that although these expressions look the same, I have updated both x and sides in between. So this is the old perimeter of the previous polygon and this is the new perimeter of the new doubled polygon. Okay. Now I say something like, if the new perimeter minus the old perimeter is less than, say, 10 to the power minus 10. Now, see, because I am starting with a lower estimate of pi and then I am strictly increasing it, the polygon is always inside the circle. The new perimeter is always larger than the old perimeter. Okay. So, I basically say that the new perimeter does not increase beyond the old perimeter by much. In fact, you could just say as soon as the perimeter starts to decrease, there is something wrong. You could also do that. Either tests are possibly okay. I have put an arbitrary threshold here. Maybe that is not so good. What I do is I change keep going to false. Okay. And then in the next iteration, keep going is found to be false and so the loop exits. So, this is one way to control the problem. So, this time I will not put the less, I will just execute it sort of out of control. Good. And it finishes with a number of sides which is around 393,000. So, it is kind of happy that beyond that nothing much is changing, 2 within 10 to the power minus 10. And then you can quit at that stage. Okay. Let us change this to if new perimeter say is less than perimeter, then we stop. Okay. That should never be, so that is the first sign of trouble. This time it ends with much more. So, 10 to the power minus 10 was overly conservative. Double can deal with more sides. In particular, it can deal with about 10 to the power 156 sides before pi starts dropping a little bit. So, here is the drop. Okay. So, after this point it dropped, I did not print the last value. Okay, it was increasing up to the last value. So, these are some of the techniques by which you arrange numerical accuracy. Okay. So, let us come back to the integration part. So, I say start of h, the base of those strips as 0.01, small enough value, and then I keep going again. I want to just print successive approximations to pi. I start off area under the semicircle as 0 and I start at x equal to minus 1. Okay. And then while the strip has not gone beyond the right edge of the semicircle, so while x plus h is less than equal to plus 1, I say area is incremented by the area of that strip. The area of the strip is h times the y value. The y value is square root of 1 minus x squared. Okay. And then I increment x by h. So, the base of the those rectangular strips is h wide. So, I shift to the next rectangle and I keep going. I add up strip by strip. Fine. And then at the end of this area accumulation, this is the inner while loop which finishes the area accumulation. I print the h value and twice the area because I expect the area of the semicircle to be half pi. So, I am printing twice the area to get pi. And then I half the interval width. I say h slash equal to 2. Let us just see what happens. So, I compile this code. I can let it run free. You will see one of the effects of, you know, halving the interval width. First one is very fast, and then as I keep decreasing the h, more and more sums have to be done. So, it takes more and more time. But you can see that as h becomes thinner and thinner, the approximation again gets better and better, but it is spending a lot of time doing every successive halving because a lot of strips have to be added up and it takes time. Okay. So far mostly our programs have run instantaneously. This is perhaps the first example where the computer is not instantaneous and takes time to do things. So, I want to let it go for a little while just to see when we start suffering again because of the accuracy effects. So, rest assured that at some other point, there will again come a point where h is very tiny and so the area of each strip goes to 0, but there is like an infinite number of strips. And once again, I am having this 0 times infinity kind of evaluation and again, you know, the program is going to suffer. It is going to give worse and worse values. And once again, you can, you know, you can do something like this. So, one trick that is used to deal with it is that here is your smooth function that you are trying to sum over. Instead of saying that, okay, what we are doing is this is one strip, then that is the next strip. Okay. You can argue that this will be a strict lower bound to the area if the curve looks like we're always staying losing this kind of area here, right? So you can again say that as long as my area increases by thinning down the strip width, I'll keep going. If the area starts decreasing, there's something wrong with numerical precision, and I'll stop right there. So you can do it. So this is another example of, you know, you can compute the same number in many different algorithms. Some of them are remarkably faster than others. So clearly the Archimedes method is much faster than numerical integration in this case. This is taking a long time to reach the same level of accuracy. So in numerical analysis, which some of you will take in future, that's the study of, you know, how to most, you know, in the fastest way approximate these quantities to the most accuracy. Use as little computing power as possible. So for example, nowadays computing has become a service. You don't need to buy your own computers. You can pay Amazon some money and say, I'll use your farm of computers for 2 days to do some molecular simulation, and I'll pay so much per hour. Okay. Now if you want to optimize the amount of money you're paying to Amazon while getting your computation done, then you need to find the best possible algorithm so that your value is computed with minimum CPU effort to the maximum accuracy. Okay. So that's why optimizing accuracy with finite precision is very important. Let this continue. We'll see if at some point we hit NAND, although this might make my machine a little slow. Any questions on this so far? So we took this problem of approximating pi. Now why do you want to approximate pi? Okay. Well, it's not just that. We can use similar techniques to integrate any surface or integrate any function and so on. Yes. It could do that because of various effects, but the first, it should, theoretically it should never decrease. So the first decrease shows you trouble. Yes, after that you can do all kinds of crazy things. So this was this case where we had one loop nested in the other. The outer loop was in charge of halving the base of the strips. The inner loop was in charge of adding up the area. Okay. So gradually we'll write much more complicated code. You can, in scientific code, you can easily have 5 or 6 levels of nesting of loops. It's quite common. Okay. And you need to work out the variables carefully and understand what's going on. So what's the moral of the story? Well, I don't know if we like morals. On an ideal computer, increasing the number of polygon sides or decreasing interval width h without bound should get you better and better estimates. In practice, the limitations of finite precision arithmetic, your hardware limitations, prevents this. And this is why we need to know our hardware representation. Okay, if I didn't talk to you about how double and long and so on are represented, you would be completely mystified by this and will not understand what to do. Okay. In general, limit-like expressions are troublesome to evaluate reliably because of this 0 by 0 or 0 times infinity effect. Luckily, for many, many mathematical expressions and quantities, there are far better ways to evaluate them, for example, as convergent series. So you don't need to find pi using this trick. There are other expressions for pi which are series that keep on decreasing monotonically term to term, and those are much safer to evaluate. Okay. So the first example of a nice series which converges is e to the power x. Okay. So this is a well-known series. E to the power x equals 1 plus x squared plus x squared over 2 factorial plus x cubed over 3 factorial and so on. So in general, the sum is okay, so everyone knows this. So we initialize an answer to 1. So in this case, for simplicity, I have already taken the first term into account because even e to the power 0 is at least 1. So the minimum value of e to the power x is 1, so we'll start off with 1 for positive x. So we assume that x is positive here. So initialize answer to 1, and then we have base equal to x. Now remember that I have to compute this factorial, right? And so the denominators look like 0 factorial, 1 factorial, 2 factorial, etc. Okay. Now we've already seen how to compute factorial. But surely I'm not going to recompute factorial from scratch for each of the expressions, right? What I should do is use the previous factorial to compute the new factorial. So each term is like x to the power I over I factorial. The next term is x to the power I plus 1 divided by I plus 1 factorial, right? So I shouldn't really be using all those smart techniques earlier to do x to the power I every time. I should really go from this term to the next term by saying that x to the power I plus 1 is nothing but x to the power I multiplied by x, and I plus 1 factorial is nothing but I plus 1 times I factorial. This will be the most efficient way to compute the parts of the expression. So FAC holds this value, and base will hold the whole numerator. So I start off my answer with just the first term, which is 1, assuming x is positive. And then I have this keep going thing again. I don't want to keep going forever because we need to get e to the power x within finite time. So the first thing I do is answer plus equal to base over FAC. Okay. For the first time, what happens? For the first time, base is equal to x and FAC is equal to 1. So I started off with 1, I get the next term, which is x divided by 1. Okay. And then what do? I multiply base by x. So what used to be x becomes now x squared. And what does FAC become? So I also have this index called ix, which corresponds to I over there. Okay. So I multiply FAC or the factorial by ix, and then I auto increment ix to the next iteration. And you can forget this for the moment. It's clear that if I executed the loop forever, I would get a closer and closer approximation to e to the power x. Okay. So let me trace this pseudocode on paper with symbolic values to show what's happening. So the variables are answer, base, FAC, and ix. Okay, that's the four variables in the code. If you haven't, have you written down the pseudocode, or should I write it on the board? How many have written down the pseudocode and can follow only this screen? Otherwise, let me spend a couple of moments to write down the pseudocode. So I'll not bother with the termination condition for now. So say while true. Okay. The basic action is answer plus equal to base by factorial, and base is multiplied by x, the input, and factorial is multiplied by ix plus plus. Okay, and then I'll drop the rest of the loop to simplify my. So this is the code. I start off with answer equal to 1, base equal to x, FAC equal to 1, ix equal to 1. Okay. And then right in the beginning of the loop, I say answer plus equal to base over FAC. So answer becomes 1 plus x over 1. Then base is multiplied by x, so it becomes x squared. Factorial is multiplied by ix. Okay. So is this correct? This may be wrong, right? Should I have taken the first term, I'm going over to the next one. So this should be plus plus ix, okay? So let me change the code over here. Yeah. But let me just change the code as little as possible. Suppose I do that. So then FAC becomes 2 and ix becomes 2. Now in the next iteration, what happens is answer becomes x plus 1 plus x squared over 2, okay? Base becomes x cubed, FAC becomes 2 times 3, so that's 3 factorial. This is actually 2 factorial, okay? And ix becomes 3. So then I get 1 plus x over 1 plus x squared over 2 plus x cubed over 3 factorial, and so on. Okay. So of course, to see if I can quit, I check if base over factorial goes below some epsilon. And in that case, I set keep going to false, and then I bail out of the loop. Okay. So I set again epsilon to some arbitrary 10 to the power minus 10, and I set double x equal to 1. So I'm finding just e to the power 1, so that we can recognize it as e. Okay. Answer equal to 0 to start with, base equal to 1, etc. Okay. So this time I can actually start from the very first term. So and then if base etc. keep going equal to false. Okay. And then in the next iteration, because while we'll find keep going false, it will quit. And in this case, I'm printing out iteration by iteration. I'm printing out iteration number and the answer to a lot of significant places. So let's compile this. This is still continuing, by the way. Locally, its value seems to be still increasing. Okay. So see, the Archimedes method reached similar accuracy very, very fast. So this is finding e to the power 1. So this is really the number of terms that have been included in the sum. And within 13 iterations, I decide that the base divided by factorial has become so small that I don't care, less than 10 to the power minus 10. And so the answer found is very close to what you recognize as E. Okay. And why is the answer shrinking to 0 so fast? Because there is factorial in the denominator. Okay. Factorial, as you know, is reaching astronomical values very, very quickly. And so 10 to the power minus 10 is nothing. Within very few terms, just 13 terms, I'm done. Okay. So that's how you'd compute e to the power x in general and e to the power 1 in particular. So the next observation is that quitting a loop every time by declaring a Boolean value like this and testing it and then setting it for a termination condition, and then it's painful, right? I had to declare a new Boolean variable. So Boolean is from Java. This is wrong. It should be just bool. So that's tedious to have to declare a variable, change it if a particular condition is met, test it, and so on. So that's why the break statement was introduced in the language. So we start out saying while true with the intention of carrying through it for all eternity, and then we do the same thing as before. This time there's probably a bug. It should be plus plus. And if the termination condition is met, if base over fac is less than epsilon, then I say just break. And break has the effect of terminating the immediately enclosing while loop. So the arrow shows that that break statement effectively cancels all remaining infinite iterations of the while loop, and it returns control to the first statement after this curly bracket. So for example, you can print the value, final value there instead of printing all intermediate values. Okay. So let's change our code to do that. So I'll not declare this Boolean variable. I'll start out saying while true, and I'll say break, and I'll finally just print out. After the while loop, I'll print out this value. So again, this printf is an equivalent for printing out, but it prints more to more precision. That's all. So at iteration 14, it prints out the final value. So we started out reviewing the fancy raising something to a power using squaring trick. Then we reviewed that, and then we looked at several more examples of while loops. You can, the fun examples were where we were computing the value of pi by summing up the perimeter of polygons of increasing number of sides inscribed in the circle. And then we saw that the obvious limit is not what you get with finite precision arithmetic, because zero edge length is multiplied by infinite number of edges. And there are various ways of trying to solve it. You could use domain knowledge from your program or application to note that decreasing perimeter is wrong and you can stop there. Or you can have some error threshold, and whenever pi, the value stabilizes to within that window, you can quit. The next thing we saw was numerical integration by taking a function and then looking at the area under it as being composed of a bunch of tiny strips. We can add up the area as an approximation to the true integration. And the thinner we make the strips, the closer you approach the area. But once again, there is this problem that as the area of each strip goes to zero and the number of strips goes to infinity, finite precision arithmetic can again not deal with it very well. Okay. And then we said that, well, for certain functions, you can avoid the limits and you can compute e to the power x as a series. Okay. Now, by the way, many of you might know that e can also be expressed as various limits, right? So, limit x tends to infinity 1 plus 1 over x to the x, that's also e. Okay. But you would be ill-advised to try to compute e this way for that same reason, because it looks like something that's just slightly more than 1 raised to an infinite power, this is real recipe for disaster. Okay. It's even worse than what we have seen. All right. So you should avoid using that kind of technique. So we also saw how one of the methods for computing pi's was way faster than the other and gave you much more accurate values of pi far before the other one had, you know, even gotten underway. Okay. So any further questions, clarifications on this? And now you see why break is used. You can quit a loop early or whenever you feel like without declaring a variable and testing it in the next iteration. In fact, in many applications, trying to repeat the beginning of the loop body would be wrong or it will mess up your invariants and so on. It's much better to quit the loop as soon as you can. Okay. Yeah, so why are you developing algorithms to compute powers of numbers or pi or e to the power x if you already have these library functions? Someone already wrote the library functions for us. Why do we care? Because techniques like taking limits, numerical integration, series summing, these are universal. You'll use it again and again in doing scientific programming or engineering programming. And also it familiarizes us with the loop and break constructs so far. Okay. There are other ways to write loops using the for construct and the do while construct. We'll see that. But while is universal. You can implement anything using while. It might just look a little messy. Code might become more compact if we could use a for loop, and we'll see for loop in the next lecture. Okay. So let's continue with some more small problems where while loops can be used gainfully. Questions, doubts? So here is a puzzle, it's a counting problem. So let's say the input to the program is an integer which is len for length. Okay. And the question is, how many sequences of len bits are there, say 50 bits, 60 bits, which do not have two consecutive zeros? Because this could be like an interview question, if you will. Okay. So let's give things names. Okay. This is, of course, a function of length. Roughly, intuitively speaking, the number of sequences of length. So first of all, how many sequences of length bits are there without any restrictions? 2 to the power length, right? Just like how many sequences of 8 bits are there, that's 256. Okay. But now we have this restriction that it can't have two consecutive zeros. Okay. Intuitively, you would still feel that this number should increase with len. The more bits I give you, the more configurations there are. And in spite of this restriction, you would expect that the answer will increase with len, say. So let that number be something, some function of length. We'll express that answer as a sum of two parts. A of length is the number of sequences that end with 0, okay, without having any two consecutive zeros. And B of length is the number of sequences that end with a 1 without having any consecutive two zeros inside it. Okay. So the required answer is A of length plus B of length. So if a sequence ends with a 0, then by law, the second last bit has to be a 1. Otherwise, you would have two consecutive zeros. Right? Therefore, A of length must be B of length minus 1. Is this clear? So, you know, in longhand is the number of len bit sequences ending in 0, no two consecutive zeros. Okay. B len is same thing ending in 1. So suppose I tell you that a particular string ends with a 0, then surely this bit cannot be a 0, this has to be a 1. So how many len bit strings end with zeros? Well, the same number as ends with a 1, you know, with 1 less, right? So A of len is equal to B of len minus 1, and meanwhile what is B of len? Okay, if the sequence ends with a 1, okay, then the previous bits can be anything. So therefore B of length is equal to A of length minus 1 plus B of length minus 1. If the bit sequence ends with a 1, then the previous bit could be either 0 or 1, there is no restriction. So now A of len minus 1 is B of len minus 2, right? If A length is B length minus 1, then A of length minus 1 is B of length minus 2. So I can write B of length as B of length minus 2 plus B of length minus 1. So let's start with small cases. Suppose I tell you length equal to 1, just 1 bit sequences. Okay. Now of course a 1 bit sequence cannot have 2 consecutive zeros. So how many such bit sequences are there? Okay. Just 0 and 1, right? So we can set up, I think there is some small bug in the slide. The base cases with A of 0 bit. So if you have only 0 bits, or let's say, well, I don't know, let's say with 1 bit, so let's set the base cases properly. So 1 bit sequences ending with 0 which have no consecutive zeros, there's only 1, right? And 1 bit sequences ending with 1 which don't have to, again just 1. Okay. So the base cases are A1 equal to B1 equal to 1. Fine. Now note that B length depends on only B length minus 2 and B length minus 1. Okay. So let's write out the first few values for ease. So A1 is number of 1 bit sequences ending in 0, that is just one such, right? So that is equal to 1. B1 is the number of things ending with a 1, there is only one such, just the bit 1, okay? So that is also 1. So B1 is equal to 1, okay? How about B2? B2 is the number of 2 bit sequences without 2 consecutive zeros which end with a 1. So there is this bit, there is 1, this could be anything, 0 or 1, therefore this is B2 is equal to 2. Okay, there are 2 strings which end in 1 and which don't have 2 consecutive zeros, 0 1 and 1 1. Fine. So the base cases are B1 equal to 1, B2 equal to 2. What is B3? By definition, we saw that this is the sum of those two guys. So this is equal to 3. Okay. What is B4? That is the sum of the previous two values. So 2 plus 3, 5. Okay. B5 is 3 plus 5, 8. Okay. Anyone recognize what this series is? Right. So another way to, you know, hide the name Fibonacci is to pose this as a puzzle. Now suppose you want to calculate these sequences one after the other. Because each B value depends on only the previous two values, it is enough to keep around the last two values. You do not need to keep around, remember all the B's you have encountered, right? So how do I code that up? I would declare a length which I need to report at the end. I read that. If length is 0 or length is 1, then I will report say 0 or 1 depending on what the convention is, it is a little different. So let's say length equal to 1 or length equal to 2. I'll report A length and this equal to say the length itself. So, say base cases are A1 equal to B1 equal to 1 and B2 is equal to 2, you already saw. So, if length is 1 or 2, then we just return length as the answer. Okay, sorry for the bad formatting here. Otherwise, if length is larger, then we can clock up from 2 onwards or say 3 onwards. Okay. So, while LX is less, LX is the index, okay, I'll clock it up to reach length. While that happens, I'll say B argument for length, so B length within brackets, because you can't declare something with a bracket in it, we'll just write B len, is B len minus 2 plus B len minus 1. And then I'll print out the new value LX with B len, and then I'll shift forward one step by incrementing LX and then shifting. So, by which I mean B length minus 2 will now become B length minus 1 and B length minus 1 will become B length. Okay. So, let me show that on the board for clarity, hopefully without protest from the PA system. So, think I am on this infinite slotted storage. Okay. Here is length, therefore here is len minus 1. And this is len minus 2. Okay. The basic step of computation is very simple. I take this, I take that, I add and I store here. The next value is the sum of the previous two values. But because I have a limited number of variables, I am sliding them along this array. Okay. So, what I do is, this value is called B len. This value is called B len minus 1. And this value is called B len minus 2. Okay. And let's say at some point we had these values 2, 3 and 5 over here. So, this was 2, this was 3. After adding it, this had value 5. Right. To be able to move on to the next position, what I do is I wipe out 3, I copy, sorry, 2, I copy 3 into it. Okay. I wipe out this 3, I copy 5 into it. And then I compute 8 here. That is equivalent to saying that the upper series remained the same. I slid B len to this one, I slid B len minus 1 to this cell, and I slid B len minus 2 one step. So, I have 3 variables which are trying to represent this sliding window on this sequence. Okay. And after computing each value, I logically slide all the variables forward by one step. And that is how I manage within 3 variables. Okay. So, this is how you can compute the Fibonacci sequence one after the other number. And A len and B len are related in a very simple way. So, if you really wanted to report the number of such sequences, it's fairly easy to compute alongside and report the number. Okay. So, now for the more interesting exercise which you can do as a homework, which is okay, I can always compute the number of such sequences. Can you print them out one after the other? Okay. So, suppose I said don't just give me the number of such sequences, actually write out all the sequences. So, I'll give you an input number say 20, write out all the sequences which have 20 bits in them, but do not have 2 consecutive zeros anywhere. Okay. So, that's a much more fun exercise. I'm not sure we can do it immediately, but for those of you who are getting along fine, you can think about it. Okay. Gradually, we'll talk about how to enumerate those things. Now, as you know, these things can get out of hand very quickly, just like factorial. Fibonacci also grows fairly quickly. Okay. Every variable is the sum of its 2 previous values. So, there is roughly an exponential growth. It's not as bad as factorial, but it's sort of like exponential. Okay. So, the number of sequences grows very fast. And so, if you enter into your PC, write out all these sequences up to length 50, you'll probably wait for, you know, several Big Bang cycles or something to print out, not the serial, but the actual Big Bang in the universe, for it to print out all the such sequences. Okay. So, I'm not too sure this belongs here, but I will just go ahead and finish the last example for while that I have. And then in the next lecture, we will start with for loops. For loops are nothing fundamentally too different from while loops, but they give you some syntactic comforts. You can do a bunch of things together. Okay. So the next problem I'll discuss is how to reverse a string. So I get a message, hello world, and I want the first letter to become the last letter and vice versa, right? So if your input is hello, the output will become the opposite thing. The output has to be O L L E capital H. Okay. That should be the output. So how to do that? So here's a string message. I read the message, and then again I wanted to continue with this kind of a style of thinking of storage as, you know, hello as being stored in consecutive characters. So think of memory as having H here, E there, L, L and O. Okay. What do I do in the program? I read the thing using a get line. You can read up that outside. So remember, this is position 0 of the string where H is stored, and it's 1, 2, 3, 4. So that at position 4, O is stored. Okay. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. And I set up left to be equal to 0. And I set up right to be equal to the last one. Message.size is 5. And right points to that. Okay. And now I am going to exchange the left with the right and make this travel. So left will increase, right will decrease. So, and while left is still to the left of right, otherwise I am done, I will load into a temporary variable temp the character h. So temp will be equal to h, okay, h in quotes actually. And then I will overwrite, because I have already saved h, I will overwrite this with o, and finally message write will become temp. So this will become h. So now I am done with the two extreme positions, and I will increase left and I will decrease right. So it is a very obvious algorithm. There are some details which look intuitive enough, but you might not be familiar, which is what does message box left mean. So message is like an array of characters, and message of left is the storage cell of message.left. Okay. But one interesting thing is that on the left hand side, message left means here is a cell to write into, whereas on the right hand side, message left means read out of that cell and give me the value. So when you access arrays, arrays on the left hand side of an expression means something slightly different from the right hand side. So we'll look at arrays 2 weeks from now, and we'll see more details of that.